It's hard to imagine that the man responsible for the Nazis' deadly V2 weapon was also responsible for NASA's majestic Saturn V rocket.
We have a liftoff on Apollo 11.
Wernher von Braun is one of the most controversial scientists in history. He wasn't just any scientist at NASA, he was the scientist who got us to the moon. So how did the man who worked for Adolf Hitler become an American hero? Von Braun was born on March 23, 1912, in the small town of Wierzyce in present-day Poland, which was then part of the German Empire. When he was young, the Braun family settled in Berlin, where his father worked at the Ministry of the Interior. He came from a wealthy, aristocratic family. His mother encouraged his curiosity by giving him a telescope when he was a teenager. It helped fuel his interest in astronomy and space.
You think that as a rocket scientist, he would have aced math and physics, but actually he didn't do all that well at school, at least not at first.
The turning point came when he read The Rocket into Planetary Space by rocket pioneer Hermann Oberth and decided to apply himself to calculus and trigonometry so he could master the physics of rocketry. While studying mechanical engineering at the Technical University of Berlin, von Braun joined an amateur rocket association and caught the attention of the German army, which recognized his talent. They offered to finance his PhD research if he helped develop liquid fuel rockets for the military. He got his doctorate in 1934, a year after Hitler came to power. With war on Hitler's mind, rocketry became a top priority for the German government. And who better to lead the program than von Braun, whose ambitions were out of this world? While a student, he attended a presentation by Swiss physicist Auguste Piccard, famous for his hydrogen balloon flights. Afterward, von Braun approached Piccard and said, "You know, I plan on traveling to the moon at some time." Piccard is said to have responded with encouragement. Although he would never go to space himself, von Braun is responsible for getting the first humans to the moon on the Apollo 11 mission in 1969. At the time, the American public knew very little, if anything, about his past as a member of the Nazi Party and an SS officer.
There is no existing photo of von Braun in which you can clearly see him in his uniform.
The closest is this photo of him wearing the Nazi Party badge on his suit lapel, although even this isn't all that clear. The US government largely hid his background until after his death. He was among hundreds of German scientists, engineers, and technicians recruited as part of Operation Paperclip at the end of World War II. Although President Truman forbade recruiting Nazi members or supporters, US intelligence agencies eliminated or whitewashed incriminating evidence of possible war crimes from their records. Von Braun was the star recruit. He was the brains behind the Nazis' V-2 ballistic missile, the first object to go into space, defined as 62 vertical miles out or 100 kilometers, and effectively launched the space age. Von Braun led the team that developed the V-2 at a secret laboratory at Peenemünde, located on a northern German island. From there, they built and tested the rockets by launching them into the Baltic Sea. The V in V2 stands for the German word Vergeltungswaffen, which means vengeance. This was vengeance weapon number 2. V2s attacked Allied cities in retaliation for the Allied bombings against German cities. They were used in the latter stages of the war and were a last-ditch effort by the Germans to ward off defeat.
The V2 was a totally new kind of weapon. It was the world's first large-scale liquid propellant rocket.
Instead of weapons with 100 pounds of thrust, it had 55,000 pounds of thrust. The Nazis launched over 3,000 V2s equipped with a one-ton warhead, targeting Western Europe, mostly Britain and Belgium. They flew at more than 3,000 miles an hour, or 4,800 kilometers an hour, and could reach London in 5 minutes. Because they came in at over 3 times the speed of sound, the V2 made absolutely no sound until after it hit, so it crashed and exploded without warning. It is estimated to have killed between 5,000 to 9,000 civilians and soldiers. Yet, more than twice as many people are believed to have died producing them. The Nazis forced prisoners from concentration camps to build the rockets at the Mittelwerk factory underneath a mountain in central Germany to avoid enemy air attacks. Prisoners did 12 hours a day of back-breaking work, pushing heavy equipment in areas filled with dust and noxious gases from the blasting to widen the tunnels. Conditions were far worse than depicted in this Nazi propaganda photo. They slept in the tunnels they dug. Their only toilets were oil barrels cut in half with boards over them. Because there wasn't enough, many relieved themselves in the tunnels. The stench was intolerable. Starvation and poor hygiene exacerbated outbreaks of typhoid and tuberculosis. The Nazis recruited prisoners who had technical skills, such as welding, to build the rockets. Those accused of sabotaging their production were hanged from cranes above the rocket assembly lines. When von Braun was later asked by a reporter if he was aware of the slave labor that built the V-2s, he said, "Well, you're misinformed. The slave camp was about 400 miles from where I worked. I learned later on that there were atrocities taking place there. But I was not involved in this whole operation. I've nothing to hide. I've nothing to hide."
However, historians are certain von Braun saw the horrific conditions with his own eyes.
Michael J. Neufeld, author of the book Von Braun, Dreamer of Space, Engineer of War, found through his research that von Braun was in the tunnels at least a dozen times. Neufeld said that when von Braun testified at a war crimes trial in West Germany in the late 60s, he mentioned he'd been through the underground sleeping quarters. Von Braun later claimed in interviews that he really had no choice but to join the Nazis.
"I believe you were forced to join the Nazi party, as I understand it."
"No, this isn't quite right.
I got a letter
one fine day which said, we understand you would like to join the party. And he has a form, an application form, but the circumstances were such that the message would have been very loud and clear, you know, had you not sent it in."
He continued to stick to the line that he was simply a scientist who wanted to pursue the noble goal of going to space. He would later recall that he never liked Hitler, referring to him as a pompous fool with a Charlie Chaplin mustache. He was also vocal about the fact that he was arrested by Nazi Germany's secret police, the Gestapo, in March 1944, after he went to a party and, while drunk, allegedly said he foresaw the war ending badly for Germany. This was akin to treason, and he was imprisoned for about 2 weeks until Hitler's men released him to continue producing V-2s. The following year, in 1945, Germany surrendered. Von Braun had been planning for the post-war era and went south to American-occupied territory in the Alps, where he made the shrewd decision to surrender. The Americans were more than happy to snap up the brilliant mind behind Germany's advanced military arsenal. The US and the Soviet Union had never seen anything like it. They captured many V-2s for research to develop their own space programs, propelling the former allies into an arms race in the 50s. For 15 years after the war, von Braun worked with the U.S. Army to develop ballistic missiles and launch vehicles, first in Texas before being stationed in Huntsville, Alabama. While settled in America, he sailed to Europe in 1947 to bring back a bride. He married his first cousin, Maria, in southeastern Germany. He was 35, she was 18. They had three children.
"Now here's a model, my design for a four-stage orbital rocket ship."
Von Braun became one of the most prominent advocates of space exploration in the 50s and was even featured in a Disney TV show on space travel. In 1958, President Eisenhower created the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, a federal agency dedicated to space exploration. The U.S. didn't want to fall behind the Soviets, who surprised everyone by launching Sputnik, the world's first artificial satellite and man-made object, into Earth's orbit in 1957. The following year, America answered by putting its first satellite into space.
"Explorer is in orbit."
Under the direction of von Braun and his team, America's ambitions would be even bigger. President John F. Kennedy gave America the ultimate challenge.
"I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth."
Von Braun became the chief architect of the Saturn V rocket that would propel Americans to the lunar surface on July 20, 1969.
"It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind."
Apollo 11 also fulfilled von Braun's lifelong ambition, though he would have loved to have gone to space himself. In 1970, when he was prepared to leave Huntsville to take a job with NASA in Washington, he addressed a crowd and said, "My friends, there was dancing in the streets of Huntsville when our first satellite orbited Earth. There was dancing again when the first Americans landed on the moon. I'd like to ask you, don't hang up your dancing slippers." He left NASA 2 years later to work at a private aerospace manufacturing company. He continued to work even after being diagnosed with kidney cancer. The cancer caught up with him, and he was too ill to attend the White House when President Gerald Ford awarded him the country's highest science honor, the National Medal of Science, in 1975. 2 years later, on June 16, 1977. He died of cancer at a hospital in Alexandria, Virginia. He was 65 years old. Von Braun was known for two achievements that were polar opposites. One was part of Hitler's inhumanity. The other, a giant leap for humanity. It's easy to label someone a hero or a villain, to see things as black and white, but real life is complicated, and so was Von Braun. What was clear is that above all else, Von Braun loved space. While a student, he read an article imagining a trip to the moon, and recalled, "It filled me with a romantic urge, interplanetary travel. Here was a task worth dedicating one's life to, not just stare through a telescope at the moon and the planets, but to soar through the heavens and actually explore the mysterious universe. I knew how Columbus had felt." Von Braun achieved his dream because of his determination to master calculus and trigonometry so he could understand the physics of rocketry. If you'd like to improve your STEM skills, Brilliant is my go-to platform to improve my critical thinking and problem-solving skills. And it's free for you to try out.
I know my viewers love the scientific thinking course, where you can explore the laws of physics and the principles of engineering by learning as you play. I really like that it's super interactive.
There's something for everyone on Brilliant, no matter your age or experience level. You can start your algebra journey with an introduction to variables and equations with their pre-algebra course, or begin your math journey by seeing fractions, percents, and ratios in everyday contexts with their everyday math course. If you're ever stuck on a problem, you can view the explanation for more. Brilliant is free for you to try out if you head to my custom link, brilliant.org/newsthink, which is in my description. And the first 200 people who sign up with my link will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription, which gives you access to all of their course offerings. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.